Hey friends, did you know that Azure Container Storage is the first platform-managed cloud-native container storage solution in the industry? Now you can focus on running production-scale, stateful workloads and applications without worrying about managing storage. Vaibhav Ramadas is here to show me how it works today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday with here at Vaibhav. How are you?
Hey Scott, thanks for having me here.
Good to see you. So you've been working on some cool stuff with the team, Azure Container Storage, fully managed.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're here to talk about Azure Container Storage, which is currently in preview. And so it's ready for everyone to go ahead and try out. Well, so we'll talk a little bit about this. So over the last few years, we've seen a lot of users deploy production scale safer workloads. So these are things like Kafka, Elasticsearch, you know, AI ML application like Kubeflow and so on. And so when you use these different application types, you want to, and deploy them onto Kubernetes, you want to be able to deploy and run storage that can serve up these application workloads. And so when we look at kind of what's out there for users to use today, a lot of the applications need to use infrastructure services, which were built for VMs, right? They don't work super great for containers. And so Azure Container Storage really simplifies this. It's built for and works great and scales well with Kubernetes and containers.
Okay, so I'm hearing you say that I've got these infrastructure services available to me. We've talked about storage on the show before. I could maybe roll my own, but it might not be highly optimized for containers coming and going, pods spinning up, and nodes coming and going.
Absolutely. So you can very much use the storage services today. However, when you want to run at container scale, which is you're running Kubernetes and you want to really be able to create and scale up your pods really fast, you want storage to be super responsive and flexible. And so that's what Azure Container Storage brings you. It also allows you to kind of separate the storage management aspect of it that, you know, which is typically operators focus on that from kind of a simplified way for you to just deploy and use storage from your application, which is kind of what we expect developers to be focused on.
Very cool. All right. Well, let's learn more about it. What do you have for us?
Yeah, absolutely. So if you look at kind of what we have here, Azure Container Storage really provides you a layer that can abstract different types of backing stores. This can be like local SSD or remote block storage, and enables those to be consistently exposed and available to pods that are running in your Kubernetes environment. This enables you to not just have sort of reduced overall to the cost of ownership because it allows you to sort of scale within that pool, but it also provides sort of rapid deployment and scale out of these volumes that you'd use with your stateful applications. The other cool neat thing here is that we typically have users just use remote block storage like Azure Disk, but what Azure Container Storage does is it provides a unified way to use both local volumes. So for example, like the NVMe on a VM, as well as remote storage in a neat sort of consistent fashion.
Interesting. So this is Kubernetes aware. It knows that it's running in Kubernetes and that's going to provide you all kinds of things, whether it be rule-based performance scaling and data protection that is aware. Like there's cloud native and then there's cloud first. This storage knows it's in the cloud and it knows it's in containers in Kubernetes.
That's exactly right. So from a user standpoint, whether you're an operator or a developer, you're really within the frame of Kubernetes and you're interacting with this very much from within the Kubernetes control plane. And a lot of the core kind of integration points, as you called out, whether it's like data protection or other, you are really able to leverage the Kubernetes, existing Kubernetes experiences for all of that.
Interesting. So this is really thoughtfully architected. You've got that storage pool, that data services layer, and then that protocol layer that is aware of what's going on inside. Excellent.
That's exactly right. Just to kind of share a little bit more about what's actually going on inside, to kind of what you mentioned, there are these three different layers. So we have Azure Container Storage itself that's sort of deployed very tied in with AKS. And we have the storage pools. And as I mentioned earlier, the pools can be kind of like local ephemeral disks or remote disks. And they are exposed in a consistent fashion via Azure Container Storage. Now, what the data services layer really brings in is it brings in things like snapshots, encryption, and so on, that kind of layer on top of these different backing stores. So you have those consistent experiences for volumes. And these volumes are exposed to pods and application pods that are running inside of AKS using remote protocol. So in this case, it uses NVMe off as a way for the application pods to sort of mount and use the volumes themselves.
Interesting. So then Kubernetes knows about these things. The pod knows about this storage. But I assume the application can choose to care or not. The application may just want to write its data to storage and just have it work. Like I, as an app developer, I may not want to think about these things.
Yeah, absolutely. So as an app developer, you're basically just using typical sort of Kubernetes constructs. So typically you'll deploy like a stateful set, and those use what are called as persistent volumes. And these are just different types of persistent volumes. So it is a specific kind of storage class that you specify in the persistent volume definition. But really, from a typical Kubernetes developer perspective, nothing changes. It's exactly kind of how you'd expect to deploy and run storage.
And Kubernetes pods come and go. Things get knocked over. Things may crash. Things may scale. I want that persistent volume to be consistent, and I want it to attach quickly so I can get back and going quickly.
That's exactly right. So when you look at Kubernetes, you're both looking at fast initialization as well as rapid scale-out, and you're also looking at failover, right? So as pods may move over between nodes in a particular cluster, you want that storage to be responsive and instantaneously available to your application. So this really enables that, especially through the use of the remote protocol construct.
I love it. Can we see a demo?
Yeah, absolutely. So let me first show you a super quick summary of kind of what the setup is. So Okay. Imagine this is like your Contoso lab, and this could be a school or ML enthusiast. So as these users sort of come in, there's an administrator that has set up like a hub environment, which is a Jupyter Hub environment. And this is set up so that every time a user logs in, they're allocated a user space, right? A Jupyter Hub, Jupyter Notebook session. This really is in the form of a pod. So the pod lights up, and then you are provided a volume which stores the state of your user session, right? And so you want these pods to light up quickly as users log in, as well as the storage to be stood up and be usable very, very fast. One more thing to call out here is what storage actually gets deployed is specified as part of the config file. We'll kind of look at that together. The config file has like a storage class, and that's the class that determines what will pop up. So to get this started, let me first show you what's actually pre-deployed in the environment. So I have here a typical AKS cluster, and this has two node pools in place, which is kind of the user and the agent node pools, which are kind of your default. And this is running 1.26 of Kubernetes. And what you have here, though, is the extension. So we have an Azure Container Storage extension that's deployed and configured in this environment as a preset. And what we have also done is created a storage pool. So let's go take a quick look at that. So I'm just using my command line configured with kubectl. So I'm going to go ahead and do a describe on my storage pool that I have created. So this is my Azure Disk storage pool. And it is in the AZ store namespace. And so this pool basically is a type Azure Disk. So that's kind of the backing store. And it has a provision capacity of 1 terabyte. So that's the pool of capacity that we're working with in the context of this specific backing store. Now, what I'm also going to quickly show you is if I do kubectl get storage classes, this pulls up the different storage classes that are available to me as a developer. And so you can see that when I created the storage pool, it pre-creates the Azure Container Storage, Azure Disk storage class, so I can use that as part of my deployment or SQL set. And this is sort of available to me. So now that we've sort of seen this, we'll jump over and look at the Jupyter Notebook setup and see what we're going to pass as a config file to it. So what I'm going to do is quickly pull up the config file. So here you see the config file that we're going to pass to Jupyter Hub. And there's just two simple things here. One is every time a user logs in, we're going to allocate a 1 gig dynamic volume to the user. And this volume is going to get provisioned from the storage class Azure Container Storage Azure Disk, right? So that's really what's going on. And I also specified administrative user, which is the admin user. All right, so this is kind of what we're going to pass. So I will go ahead and do a install of Jupyter Hub itself. Here we are pulling down the Jupyter Hub environment, and we are creating a namespace within Kubernetes with the JHub1 namespace to deploy the application itself, right? So that just takes like a couple seconds we'll get that going. So this is really using that config file that I just showed and then deploying Jupyter Hub onto my Kubernetes cluster environment. Here we get some neat information on how to actually use this, like what are the different commands I can use to interact with Jupyter Hub. One of the things here is for me to actually just pull this up on the web, I'm going to do a quick port forward so I can look at this on my sort of local host. So I'll go ahead and run that. And now that forwarding is happening, we can go take a look at this in my local browser. So I'll go ahead to localhost and we will pull this up.
I've done that so many times.
All right. So this is the Jupyter Hub environment that is getting pull forwarded from my local machine. And so I'm just going to use admin user. Obviously, you know, we want to use all the right security in the right construct. This is just a quick demo. We have the Jupyter Hub environment itself loading up with that administrative user that was configured.
So hang on. Did I see just for a moment there, it said attaching and provisioning disk or something, and it just went by?
Yes. So basically, for the administrative user, it also creates a volume, which is a PVC, and allocates it to the administrative user. So I, like any other user, can go ahead and actually use the Jupyter Notebook environment that's here.
Yeah.
Right? So it does sort of very quickly provision that PVC volume alongside the pod that was set up for me.
Yeah. I guess I was expecting it to like go through the progress bar and pause for 20 seconds while it set the disks up. So I was kind of like, hang on.
It was great and super quick. That's exactly right. And so what we're going to do here is we're going to take that up a notch, right? So this is just one user. So we're going to show basically what happens if like 50 users log in at the same time, right? And how fast this can really be. So to do that, I'm going to use the Jupyter Lab API. And to hit the API, I need a token. So I'm going to get my token and then go interact with this using Python. So here I will go get my token. So here I request a new token. So I'm just going to say Contoso J-Hub. And I request a token to work with. And I'll switch over to Visual Studio Code. Now we have a Python script that is already here. And so let me quickly go through this. So it's a simple Python script. I'm going to be putting in the token that I just got, saving that, making sure it's available for me. And I'm just simply creating a set of usernames and passing it through Jupyter Hub's API. Right. So this really helps me create the users. And then I can use those users to create sessions that users will interact with.
So you're doing a bit of naive stress testing. It could have been Playwright. It could have been Chaos Studio. It could have been whatever. But this is a nice for loop that goes and says, here's a bunch of new users, logs them in, boom, 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 really, really fast.
Exactly right. This is, you know, simple for demo purposes. But it's a fairly simple REST API that you can hit and use with your most favorite.
You have pretty pauses in here. You have a sleep half a second there on line 42.
I do.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So let me go ahead and I'll start a new command prompt and I will run the script here. So this is the script that we just looked at. So I'll go ahead and run that. So you see that the users are starting to get created, right? And then the sessions are starting to get created as well. And so each of these is creating a pod behind the scenes. So let's take a quick look at that. So if I do a kubectl get pods, sorry, I need to specify my...
For our namespace. Cool.
Namespace that I just created. So you can see that these user pods are starting up, right? So there you see 50 of them are getting initialized for us. So we can quickly see that.
And some are pending, some are running, and then each time you do it, it's more and more are running.
Yeah, absolutely, right? So basically, Jupyter Hub is initializing all of these different sessions. Mm-hmm. And so the thing that's exciting, though, is if we look at the PVCs, You can see that the PVCs, all 50 of them, were already created and available to Kubernetes to use, right?
Wow. So you're ahead of, like, you're ready for Jupyter Hub, which is probably still spinning up in some instances. You just made 50 gigabytes, 1 gig per user happen like that.
Yeah, exactly right. So you can kind of see the initialization time. So the admin user was created first. So when we initialized Jupyter Hub itself, and then all of these other users have gotten kickstarted with their session environment in the PVCs all ready to go. And so that's kind of how fast this is. So just kind of jumping back, just to recap what we looked at, we have a Jupyter Hub environment. You go in and create multiple sessions and you get allocated stateful pods and volumes kind of instantaneously as that, you know, ramps up. And also, this is just a test of like 50 users to show here, but we've tested this with like thousands of pods. And so it is super, super fast. And we've really been able to get up to like 3,000 pods and so on. And so that's kind of what we wanted to show you in a quick demo today.
That is pretty darn cool. Like, I remember at the beginning, just a few minutes ago, when I was like, you know, couldn't I just roll this myself? And now I'm thinking, absolutely not. I need to use Azure Container Storage because there's so many things to think about. Like we said, the scaling, whether it's rule-based performance scaling that you're aware of or not, the data protection stuff, there's so many things that I would have to think about if I were going to try to roll this myself. But having it baked in where it knows that it's in Kubernetes and to see you spin up 51 gig disks, and then that was a really cool demo. I'm impressed.
Yeah. Absolutely. And this is a very, very real use case, right? This is kind of what we actually see as part of kind of the Jupyter environments. And there's a ton of these applications that now run on Kubernetes. I also wanted to share some quick updates for users. So one, we kind of have initially launched this with a very small number of regions, but now we've expanded to all Arc-enabled regions, which is 26. We also, if the user sets up an auto upgrade, they can automatically get updates, so they don't really have to do anything. So it just sort of gets to their environment in terms of as we release capabilities and preview. We've also enabled different kind of backing stores. So there was a big request for premium SSD V2, and so we've enabled that as a pool option, as well as we have focused on providing vSize clones and so on, which are all kind of like core top features that are top of mind for users.
That is so cool. So this is out now. Folks can work with this now. And you all are a very active and available team. You even have an email address, Ask Container Storage, where people can talk to y'all because you're real humans doing real work.
Absolutely. One last thing, Scott, is for anyone who wants to learn more about this and get started, we have a quick start for installation. So this is reachable through just Azure Container Storage quick start. And here we have a super simple script for you to just deploy and use. So like one line and you are good to go to get started with this capability.
Very, very cool. Well, thank you so much. I am learning all about Azure Container Storage today on Azure Friday. Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it, watch more Azure Friday.